Hello, physics students. Today we're going to do a two-dimensional conservation of momentum problem. So that will give us a before collision and after collision. But then we're going to add on an additional segment, which is going to involve friction as an external force. And then we're going to see what happens to these two colliding objects after they collide and friction is allowed to bring them to a stop. The actual problem statement is a little lengthy. You may want to go ahead and just pause this real quick and kind of read it. I'm going to go ahead and start. What we really want to do is we want to start by diagramming it. So I've done some of that work for us where you can see these initial stages. So we have the before picture and we have the after picture. We're going to use conservation of momentum in order to initially describe what's going on. I'm given all the information I need. I'm given the masses of the objects, and I'm also given their initial velocities before they collide. I can combine all of that information and figure out what the overall momentum of my system is. The system, as we are defining it, is going to include both boxes. And what's great about these vector quantities, remember that little arrow up here means vector, is that you can look at what's going on in the x direction independently of what's going on in the y direction. So our system momentum in the x direction is what we'll tackle first. I'll call that p in the x direction, comma t for total, is going to be equal to the p in the x direction of box A plus the p in the x direction, comma b for the box B. Well, box A has absolutely no x component for its velocity. It's not going left or right at all, and so its x component velocity is zero. So I say px comma t is equal to, instead of using these p, these momentums, I'm going to transfer to an m times a v. So I need my mass, it's going to be 6 kilograms, multiplied by 0 meters per second, because that is the component of velocity in the x direction for this box down here, the 6 kilogram box. So there's no contribution to momentum in the x direction from this first guy. All of the momentum for the entire system is actually tied up in this guy. And so we need to figure out what's going on with it. You'll notice that I have my velocity vector down here at this off angle. So we actually have to come down here and we have to do some component work. I know that this is 5 meters per second. Down here, and I know this interior angle is 30 degrees. That is going to be constructed by these two components. So I have v in the x direction is going to be equal to the 5 meters per second times cosine of 30. And then over here, this vy, this is going to be equal to 5 meters per second times sine of 30 degrees. So vy, that's an easy one, is going to be negative 2.5 meters per second. I'm putting that negative sign in there to indicate this downward direction. And then my v in the x direction, this is going to be a negative also because it is leftward pointing, and I'm going to say down and to the left are my negative directions. So this is going to be 4.33 meters per second and then a negative. So here are these numbers, and I'm actually going to rewrite those off to the right. So now I can go and I can finish my work up here and in the x direction. So I have this v in the x direction that's right there. I'm working on this term. The mass of that box is 10 kilograms multiplied by negative 4.33 meters per second. So all of this combined means that my system in the x direction has a total momentum of negative 43.3 kilogram meters per second. Now I do the same for the y direction. So I'm going to have my total momentum in the y direction for my system is going to be equal to, the terms are going to look just like this. I'm going to break it out into the mv variety. So it's going to be mass times v in the y direction, comma, of block A plus the mass of block B. I should have a little subscript on these if I'm going to do it like this. Vy, comma, block B. So I'll add these together. And I come down here and remember all of the velocity is in the vertical direction for this block. And this is where it's going to come into play. 6 kg, I'm going to drop my units for a moment, times 3 meters per second. So that block is all done. Now I will add to it the Y direction information for the 10 kilogram block. So there's my 10 kilograms multiplied by negative 2.5 meters per second. This is an 18 minus a 25. And I find that Py comma T is equal to negative 7 kilogram meters per second. I'm going to clear a little bit of space here for a moment. And I want to make sure I point out to you that you can either add momentum vectors or you can add velocity vectors. Everything's going to work out fine as long as you're keeping track of what you're doing. So one way that I could figure out the total momentum of my system that's going to be carried down here is to take this negative 43, which is a leftward pointing because of that negative, and then I'll just put in the magnitude of 43.3. So this is a momentum vector that's up there. Then I have a downward pointing because it was negative of 7 kilogram meters per second. Those things would add together to get my total system momentum. And if I do Pythagorean theorem on that, I will find that this is about 43.9 kilogram meters per second. Then there's an interior angle here. I will use the tangent function, so I'll write the expression tangent of theta is equal to the opposite is 7 over adjacent is 43.3. And I'll find that theta is equal to 9.2 degrees. Ultimately, I want to report that angle as a global angle that's always referenced from the positive x direction or the eastward direction. So I'm going to do 180 degrees plus that theta, and I'm going to find that my overall global angle is 189.2 degrees. So I'm going to hold on to that. If I come down and look at the after picture, I now have a combined 16 kilogram mass that's sitting down here. And what I can do, I can use the same momentum triangle that's up here, and I can now project that onto the after collision. I can say all of those momentum characteristics must be the same even after the things collide. That is what we get from conservation of momentum. So now I can come through and I can start dividing through that momentum by a mass. And so really I'm just saying this momentum vector divided by the mass scalar is now equal to the velocity again. So where that's really handy for me right now, I can pull that same 43.9 kilogram meter per second momentum vector that had this big global angle of 189.2 degrees. And I can go ahead and treat it to figure out what the velocity of my entire system is going to be for this after picture. So I'm saying the total momentum of my system is now equal to the total mass, which was the MA plus the MB, because they're stuck together, times a shared velocity for the two of them. So I get 43.9 divided by, and then remember we said this is 16 kilograms, so divided by 16 is equal to this velocity, is equal to 2.74 meters per second. So that's how quickly these two boxes are moving down. You can come over here and you can look and you can say this vector does not represent what's going on very well, nor does that one, nor really does this one. Perhaps the best one is this kind of third quadrant vector. That's what's describing best our motion after the collision. Because one thing that has to be true, since the masses in here, those are both scalars, they cannot alter the direction of a vector. So this momentum vector that's sitting right here is described by that angle. That means this velocity vector must also be described by this angle. So I can come over and I can say that the velocity of all of these things is actually 2.74 meters per second at 189.2 degrees. So that's very useful for what I'm doing here. All we are left with is now we need to go ahead and deal with what happens after the collision when friction is pulled into this. Recall that friction is an external force, and so it is not going to allow us to continue with the same sort of conservation of momentum idea. We have to do something new. And what we're going to do is we're going to say that I have this collection of these two boxes stuck together with an initial velocity of 2.74 meters per second. So they're stuck here, and then they move down, and then they go over here with a final velocity equal to zero, and the thing that slowed them down was friction. The ultimate problem was to find the delta D. How far are these two things going to slide, and what angle are they going to slide off at? If the velocity is down at this angle that was described by this 189.2 degrees, friction is always going to oppose motion. So I can draw my friction vector. My FFK is pointing up in that direction that's opposite of my 189. That means my acceleration vector is also going to point up in that direction. And that's what's bringing this thing to a stop. So we just need to figure out something about this acceleration vector. And you will notice that all of our things are happening parallel to that black vector I have drawn. There is absolutely no reason for us to continue with a coordinate system that looks like this. That just seems really complicated. What we're going to do is we're going to rotate everything just a little bit, and now we're saying this is the positive direction and this is the negative direction. I will always know this 189, I'll just go write it over here, 189.2 degrees. That is going to be the direction of motion, and I'll bring that back in at the end. So let's take a look at this acceleration business. We know from Newton that F net is equal to mass times acceleration. There's the thing I really want to know. I also know that right now, once these things are moving, my only force is going to be that due to friction. So I'm going to set these two things equal to each other, those two sides, not the M there. But before I do that, I also know that my friction can be described as mu sub k, the coefficient of friction, times Fn. And that Fn is just equal and opposite to the Fg, the weight of the object. And so I'm going to have mu k times mass times a positive version of g, because mg was the weight of the object, and I'm just going to have kind of the absolute value of that. And if I put all of this information together, I have mass times acceleration is equal to mu k times m times g. Remember, this happens a lot for us where those masses cancel, and I find that my acceleration, the quantity of it, so I'm going to do that for absolute value, is going to be equal to the coefficient of friction, which was 0.42, remember, times this positive 9.8 meters per second squared. So I have my A is equal to 4.12, I'm just going to round it there, meters per second squared. That's great, I have my magnitude, but now I'm going to go in and take into account that direction that I had from before. This is the negative direction, this acceleration vector is the negative direction, so I'm going to say it's negative 4.12 meters per second squared. And if you look, you will find that we have everything we need to know to go in and use the appropriate acceleration equation from Newton to figure out delta D. It's going to be this one, V final squared is equal to V initial squared plus 2a delta d. My v final is 0, so 0 squared remains 0. V initial was in the positive direction of 2.74, that quantity squared, plus 2 times my acceleration is negative 4.12 meters per second squared times delta d. So this quantity here is about 7.51, we'll call it. And I'm going to put it on the left side of the equation, so it's going to need its negative sign, is equal to a negative 8.24 times delta D. So I'll divide both sides by this negative 8.24, and I find that delta D is equal to 0.91 meters. I got a positive value, but remember my positive direction is this direction. So my full, final, complete answer here, according to this problem, would be this. Written in blue, I would find that delta D is equal to 0.91 meters, that's the magnitude, at, and now I need to go back and invoke this direction, 189.2 degrees. Hopefully that made sense to everybody, and if it did, you should let your computer know.